These old cars can be a big challenge. I do all the maintenance right here in my garage. My name is Dale Bushworth. I was treated successfully for prostate cancer by Mary Bird Perkins Cancer Center at TGMC. My family doctor said that's where he would go if he had cancer. They treated me the way you want to be treated. And today, I'm cancer-free. I'm very happy to recommend Mary Bird Perkins Cancer Center at TGMC.
No matter their health care needs, from OB to emergency room visits, rehabilitation, and everything in between. More people choose TGMC for life. Terrebonne General Medical Center. It all begins here.
Welcome back. This is To Your Health segment with Terrebonne General Medical Center, and our guest is Dr. Ruth Ann Gallagher, and we're kind of talking about some hints back to school, and of course, Dr. Gallagher is with Bayou Pediatrics, and I guess one thing is, how do parents make sure that their child's backpack, is it really, it's not more harmful than it is helpful?
Well, backpacks are tricky. If used improperly, they can lead to back pains and even possibly some long-term back problems. For healthy backpack use, first thing is a child's pack should not weigh more than 50% of their weight. For example, a 100-pound child should have a 15-pound backpack, 70-pound child a 10.5-pound backpack. The height of the backpack should start 2 inches below the shoulder blades to about waist level or slightly above the waist. The bottom of the pack should rest in the curve of the lower back. It is recommended that students always wear the pack on both shoulders so that the weight is evenly distributed. You want to put your heaviest items in the back of the pack, well-padded shoulder straps, and adjust the straps so that the pack fits snugly on the student's back. So let them try on their backpack, fill it up, help them learn how to load it before they go to school. And it should be the right size. They come in different sizes for different size children. So check the size when you try on, when you pick out their backpack.
Okay, and I guess the reason for doing that is it muscle skeletal type issues, or you just want to make sure
if the pack is throwing them off too far back or to the side, this is going to cause the muscles on the other side to be out of balance and work differently, and they will complain.
All right. Now, what about the standard back-to-school immunization and health requirements that are required for back-to-school?
Okay. Well, all schools have certain immunization requirements. Most of our schools follow the state of Louisiana requirements, but be sure to check with your school. It's a good idea to take your child into the doctor for a physical and an eye exam before school starts. If you have any school health-related paperwork or forms to be filled out, bring these with you when you go to the doctor. When you schedule your appointment, be sure and let the office staff know if you have specific forms that need to be filled. So certain forms need certain types of visits. If your child is going to be playing sports, he may need a pre-participation sports physical with a release by the doctor. Again, tell the when you make the appointment that this is the kind of appointment you need. And try to fill out the parent part of these forms. That's very important before you bring your child in, especially if you're sending a teenager by themselves or with a neighbor or something.
Right.
Also make a copy of any forms that you take before you send them to school. At this visit, you can talk to your doctor about any concerns you have about required immunizations. They will be able to pull up your child's records and let you know if immunizations are due, and that can be taken care of at the time instead of having the child get a nasty note from school.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. I mean, a lot of parents, I guess they'd have concerns or just want to know, are these vaccines effective?
Yes. They're very effective. Immunization is one of the best ways that parents can protect their children against serious diseases. One of the problems we face is that because of the success of vaccines in preventing disease, many parents don't realize that children are at risk for some serious and possible life-threatening diseases. For example, in the 1950s, almost every child got measles, and some children actually died of measles. Wow. Physicians coming out of medical school today will probably, hopefully, never see a case of measles unless they go to a third world country.
Right.
So that's a drawback to the effectiveness of immunizations.
Right,
people
right.
tend to think they're not necessary, but they really are.
I guess another concern of parents, safety. I mean, are the immunizations and vaccines safe?
The immunizations are very safe. They're carefully studied for many years before they're released to the public. After release, they're continued to be monitored by physicians, researchers, and public health officials. Yes, there are always the possibility of some vaccine reactions. Most of these reactions are very minor and trivial. Some of them are a little more worrisome or bothersome to the child, but those that are really serious or possibly life-threatening are very few.
Okay. In Louisiana, what type of immunization requirements are there?
Louisiana requires 7 vaccines that they check on at different stages in school. The vaccines are the diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, or DPT. This is given as a 3-shot series in infancy, a booster as a toddler, a dose prior to kindergarten, and another booster dose around age 11. These will be the times that the schools are going to be checking: your daycare, your Head Start, your preschool, your pre-K, and your 6th graders. Along through school.
Yeah.
The hepatitis B is a vaccine that is now given in 3 doses in infancy. So that is checked usually at the daycare, pre-K
right.
level. The Hib is another vaccine that's given in infancy. 3 to 4 doses should be given before age 2. The daycare centers and Head Start look at those requirements.
And what is it? What kind of vaccine?
Hib is Haemophilus influenzae. It's a type of meningitis that
right.
was very common when I was in training, and
okay.
we don't.
There's
doctors. The young doctors in my practice have never seen it.
Okay.
Us older guys,
yeah.
we could treat it in our sleep.
Right.
It was so common in those
yeah.
days. The meningococcal vaccine is given to 6th graders, usually at age 11. So when your child turns 11, if they're in 6th grade, you're going to get a note.
Right.
They need to have the meningitis vaccine. At the same time, they'll get their DTP booster. The pneumococcal vaccine is another type of meningitis and pneumonia. That's also given in infancy and toddlers. The polio vaccine is given in infancy with their last booster dose at the pre-K or 4-year-old checkup.
Right.
And the chickenpox vaccine, 2 doses of chickenpox vaccine are now required.
Okay.
With the second dose given at the preschool end, along with the measles, mumps and rubella, or
right.
MMR.
Have those vaccines, I guess, seemed to help out? And like, I'll take polio, for example. I remember when we were a kid, we have to take it. But you don't hear of people getting polio, at least in the States here. Now,
right.
third world countries might
exactly.
be different.
Exactly. Exactly. The World Health Organization has been... that's been one of their goals, is to eradicate polio worldwide, because it is something that is felt to be doable. They had almost achieved it a few years ago, but now there's been a few pockets of polio
okay.
in some third world countries. So we still need the polio vaccine because it has not been eradicated
right.
worldwide.
Okay, and I think we have a website also in terms of, why don't you tell us a little bit about this website?
Yes, many parents have a lot of vaccine concerns, and this is an excellent website or vaccine resource. Most parents who have concerns have already searched the web and found all kind of horror stories and scare mm-hmm. tactics about vaccines. Children's Hospital of Philadelphia has a vaccine education center, which is not sponsored by any of the vaccine companies. And this is their website. If you go to that website, you can get free resources to answer all of your questions and concerns about all of the vaccines. It's an excellent website. I highly recommend it.
Okay, very good. And I guess finally, if anybody needs other information, I guess they can go to the Terrebonne General website as
yes,
well.
Yes, Terrebonne General always has nice outreach articles. Also, the American Academy of Pediatrics has a new website that is geared toward parents. It is healthychildren.org, and they have lots of tips on those sites as well.
Kind of elaborating on some of the stuff that you were able to share with
us. Yes, they give you things on immunizations, back to school, sleep, diet.
Right. It's basically all we have. We're just about out of time. I just wanted to ask you, I'm just curious, one thing, pediatrics, what age group does that, I know it's probably from infants, but how?
Pediatrics. The American Academy of Pediatrics extends our scope up through, it's actually pediatric and adolescent medicine.
Okay.
So they extend our scope up to age 21.
Right.
Some practices will sometimes go a little later than that, which we have at times, but now, and some people are younger.
Right.
Some will cut off. I think Children's Hospital cuts it off at 18. At Bayou Pediatrics, we go to 21.
All right.
I like to have my college students come back and see me.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, really. Look, Doctor, thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate you sharing that information with everybody.
Well, thank you, and I wish everyone a happy and successful school year.
All right. Very good. And we want to thank Terrebonne General Medical Center as well. And that's the conclusion of our two-year health segment with TGMC. Up next on Bayou Time, Stan Gravois and sports.